Okay, I will shortly share the screen for you with the information which is given for this hand-on here. So there's a first small exercise. Normally we do not shock the cow milk price in this only for selected countries. So that's why the first thing what you have to do that this scenario is working, please locate the GEMS, go to your GEMS installation, CapMod, inflation and trend interpolation file, and enter exactly this line here, under this line here. I mean, just as a copy here, like this, so that we can run the simulation. This is the first things I would like you to do and to introduce. Again, go to the GEMS installation in the CapMod folder. There is a file located in inflation and trend interpolation. And then this particular line, copy that here out of Wiki and put that in line number 85. Yeah? So it should be then under a very similar statement for sugar beet. Yeah? So, and if you have successfully done that, please indicate that by a plus in the chat. I show you that on my screen. So, so there is a file in our installation under GEMS. There's a folder, it's called CapMod. Not the file, but the folder. Where is it?
Should we save as a new workbook or we save in the original?
Yeah, I mean, you can just put it in this file and then it should be exactly have the same name, otherwise it's not taken up. Huh?
Okay.
So, and I can show you how it looks before and after. So this is here at this line. Just make a copy of that here. Either out of Wiki, or you can also take this statement here before, make a copy and change sugar beet to komi, which we learned is cow milk, cow and buffalo milk represented in Capri, and then save it. How many sheds? So four, so it is not enough. Yeah, a bit more, and just save it, okay. Do we have anyone who has not been able this?
How do I like insert line numbers in GAMS? Because I can open the file, but I don't have any numbers.
It's string go, G. In the IDE, I show you that. And if you go with the IDE here, is this the editor you have?
Yes.
So then you can go string and G, then go to files. And you can put here the file number. You see here it's already in my case. Yeah. Does it work with G? There's also things like go to line. Yeah, here this one. So then it's okay. So I will shortly now introduce you to the simulation and the run. So in the meantime, you can finish that. There's also a small presentation on it. It will be not that much, hopefully. This is already the result file. Should have the presentation. Seems to be not open yet. Here it is. And so, yeah, this will be our first exercise where we analyze now also with the graphical user interface the results. So we have, on the one hand, we have the simulation results, and we have our baseline. Baseline was produced already. So what we are doing here is we are focusing the complete day only on the supply module. So it means also that we are only run the model in the mode only with the supply modules. It means in the task without market module. So what is the advantage here? Of course, I mean that we have, it runs quite fast. If you select only Denmark, it should be completed on your computers within seconds. And we have a reduced set of, or we can reduce the number of sets to be run. So if you run the market module in Capri, you always have to select all the member states. Yeah, so it means there's no alternative. But if you only run the supply modules, you can select either Denmark or Denmark and Germany together, or you can run even Malta, which is only one small region. Okay, so what is the disadvantage of this approach? Of course, that we don't be surprised. We have a lot of indicators which relate to the market model are not calculated. Yes, this is clear. Yeah, because we could not say something about trades or whatever. So the result files look a bit different and by far smaller.
Sorry, Alex. Yes? We can see your presentation mode, and it makes the picture quite small. Oh. Maybe you can swap around.
This is good because I do. Does it work now?
Perfect. Yeah.
Okay. So as the presentation, or the prices are now exogenous because it's a price taker now. This Denmark as a mathematical programming model calibrated with PMP and so on. So what we can do here is that we have the calibration price. Yeah, and we shock now this price. Yeah, and we're getting a new production. And of course, if we increase something, we would expect that also, due to economic theory, that also the production will increase. Yeah? So, and this is also this unknown here. Yeah, this unknown, what I have talked yesterday about, this unknown supply function of Capri. Because as you see, we are only optimizing certain points. And of course, if we would test all the different prices, we could approximate somehow this supply function here. But in general, we can now already see, so what is the outcome of the simulation? Yeah. So if we have a price increase, as example here for cow milk, yeah. So we would at least assume from economic theory, if this supply curve is somehow upward shaped, so that also the production increases, if it's not a complete inelastic supply reaction, okay? So from this, we can make already some expectations. I mean, these are, this demand shift is not there here. So we could think of what are the consequences. But before we are doing this, here is just the pieces of code which are relevant to transfer this shock into our model code. Probably we'll do that quite fast because add additional information just for those who have an interest. So we indicated here the files. This is our scenario file. We will copy in. It's also given now in Wiki. Yeah. So we will do the same approach as yesterday, please. Yeah? So that you just copy it, then in this user sense, give it a certain name, and then we run the scenario. So we introduced the shock here as a change factor. And of course, this data parameter, we have heard about it today with these dimensions. It has not this change. So if you change the prices, this is just a change factor. Somewhere this needs also be translated in our real data parameter. And this is done in this inflation and trend interpolation file. We just modified a bit. It's working. So what we are doing here is quite easy. So we are saying, okay, the price we have here is the unit price vector for our in and outputs in a particular baseline year, so as we are now in 2030, is modified by taking the same price, it's more or less the same price information here, multiply that with our change factor. That's all. So this is more or less what we are doing now, is changing the data parameter we have seen in this GDX file viewer by 30%, and then provide that somehow to our model. That's all. If you look at the model, how does it enter the price? Yeah. So we have heard that as David in this Excel file, we have seen there's an objective function, and this objective function is looked quite easy in Excel, but it's getting a bit more complicated here in CapTree, because we have two parts. We have an objective file which consists again of several other parts. So it's a linear part. Yeah. Then we have a sum of PMP terms, as we have discussed today. Yeah. This PMP terms belongs to the levels, as we have seen in our exercise, but the story is also a bit more complex because we have also PMP terms for feeding components. Yeah. And we have PMP terms, as I said, transaction costs between land changes. Yeah. So this everything comes here together, and we also have for this land supply a certain cost. So if you're moving forest land to agricultural land, these are these costs here included. And this is one objective in total. And this linear part includes here again a new equation. And here more or less the revenues are calculated. Yeah. So what we here see is this objective here for each region we are doing. We are running right now saying, okay, we take the sum over all the products we have in these regions and multiply that with this variable. And this variable indicates the production, the endogenous production, and times a certain price. And you see here, the price is exogenous to this model. And this is what we have also shocked. So that's all. And then you run the model, yeah? And then you're getting your feedbacks and your outputs. If you look at the set definition here, yeah, this what kind of products we are producing. So you can find them in the sets, yeah, and they are stored classically with soft wheat, durum wheat, and so on. And also cow milk is here included, but we have also pork, beef. These are all more or less the kind of goods you can shock in the model, exogenous with prices, okay? And we have all feeding stuff, young animals, and so on. So what are our expectations now? We have seen that from this very small and simple graphical representation of supply curve. So supply will increase. And now the question, what will happen, of course, with land use? Yeah, we know that, I mean, if we increase cow milk prices, what kind of land use you would assume to increase?
Grassland.
Good. So so probably what is taken up more, yeah, probably fodder and feed, yeah? Also from this perspective, we should look at the results in this. Yields probably also should increase. Yeah, as I said, it would be nice to average yield so that you're moving to the more high yield breeding cows, yeah, which are represented by this dairy cow high. At trade, we cannot say anything here, yeah, because we have no trade component. Prices are exogenous, and of course, environmental indicators could be also checked. What would be the consequences? What do you think? So if having increased milk price, as example in Denmark, so what will be the greenhouse gas emissions doing? Just say something. I mean, Cora, please go ahead.
Increase. I would say increase.
Yeah.
Of course.
Yeah. And are we here considering as well imports?
Not yet. Yeah. As I said, I mean, we are just having the supply curve, but then calculating very easily, so to say, the greenhouse gas and the impacts from environmental at the supply. But we would have then also the possibility to switch on the market model, but not with the simulation, because we cannot simulate exogenous price shocks with the market model, because the market okay. model is responsible for providing the shocks, yeah, the price shocks.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So trade, in this case, we cannot analyze, we will do in the next days anyway, but the environment indicators was good, yeah? Because if we have higher prices, we have a intensification of agriculture, that's clear. And then, of course, I mean, if you have more cows, then probably you have more methane and more manure, and with manure, you have more NO2 emissions. So this is probably, we could expect a bit that the mineral fertilizer declines because you have more manure, something like this, yeah, should be observed in the data.
Okay. Sorry, Alex, just yes. One thing in that topic. So wouldn't you see as well, even if the market module is not on, mm-hmm. wouldn't you see an increase in feeding, and therefore that would be responsible supplement, let's say, to a higher greenhouse yes. gases as well?
Yeah, I mean, you would also see that, I mean, if you have increased number of cows, you would expect that some in Denmark, the fodder needs to be imported, yeah, and also it needs to be produced, yeah. So because it's ruminant, yeah, I mean you cannot feed the cow only with cereals. Yeah? So that's why this grassland interaction. These are our expectations. Look at the results, okay? Okay. How does it this exercise? Now we have time until I think I would say. Yeah, half an hour we do, and then we repeat the exercise for, so we will stop this time at 3:15. You find the exercise here also in this presentation in general. It's an introduction of the changes of the cow milk prices for Denmark. So only run without market model and for Denmark. First, prepare your scenario, which is given in the wiki. Yeah. Also in this presentation, you see that here. Later on, you can double click and then copy it. This should work. And then save that, yeah, because we do not use the policy editor. Save that under the GEMS user scenario as yesterday with a specific name. Then run that scenario for Denmark. Then first prove if the price shock you have introduced was really transmitted into the model. So it means you should look at prices. Yeah, so you should have observed then a price increase of 30%. And then your exercise will be to fill in this gap-filling text here, this clues, with respect to what is the supply of milk increase? Yeah, we expect it already because increase in prices. What is the own price elasticity? Yeah. What are the herd sizes? And I think we have three groups again. So I think the first group will look at supply, milk increase, and own price elasticities. Yeah, this is quite easy, I think. The second group will look at the herd sizes. And maybe the third group will look at total agriculture income. And everything which is here under input costs. So this is also one topic, and all others, yeah, all three groups also look at the development of grassland. Okay, so and if you have solved that and find the figures, how much percentage and so on, then you can of course also look at some other questions. But the first group will look at this first two points, which relate to each other quite a lot. The second group will look at this, the third group at this, and you all will look at the same time for the grassland expansion, okay? Here I indicated, so to say, where to look for the figures. Yeah, you have now the exploiter. You have learned that from your tutorial, yeah, that you load in the reference file and then the Denmark file, if you have loaded it in. Then you can look here for supply hectares, herd sizes, income by activity at the folder, yeah, or at the menu content bar, farm supply details. Yeah, you find welfare, revenues, costs, income over welfare and welfare overview. Yeah? So that you not need to look at all the different tables. Yeah? And I also indicated price changes and quantities can be observed in welfare economic accounts for agriculture. Yeah. The same for aggregated land change, look at farm land supply curve. Yeah. So these are the indications. Milk product you have learned, it's COMI. Yeah. Animal activities you have to look for dairy cows. Is dairy cow low and high yield? I mean, these are the indications. And in the GUI, this is a bit the nice thing, yeah, instead of looking only at the numbers in the GDX files, you have measures, units and long texts, yeah, so you can read that in a human readable way, the results. So now your question, and otherwise good luck, and we will help you, that's for sure.
Yeah, can you go back to the previous slide? It doesn't really matter. To the slide where you have relevant tables in the exploiter. Now, just to say that the presentation that I have here, I don't know with the others, it's not the same as the one that you're showing.
Oh, I was updating this yesterday. So maybe have you downloaded it right now? Or
I don't know when I downloaded this. Maybe yesterday.
This
morning.
Yeah. No, this morning should not be. I mean,
okay, maybe yesterday.
This is this one here. Yeah. But what I mean?
I'll do it straight quickly. So
I tried to get it. I hope that I have linked that to the wiki. It's a lot of interlinkage work to provide you all the informations. But so the others have at least the presentations as it was. I just added here, to be honest, these farm land supply.
So I think it's fine. I think
it's fine. You can. So the last year it was also working. Good. So I think this is really an exercise. Yeah, which can be really completed by running also the scenario. Yeah, because it's not that much demanding and it does not take that long. I will stop sharing and there are some. I have downloaded now. It looks the same. Good. Perfect, Anna.